sharing my story with you because I truly believe what I've been told and learned to believe, that if we all know what hatred can do, it will end. We will not permit it to continue because it persecutes our children and all those we love the most. So I tell you a story of hatred, but in my case, it had a very happy ending, very, very rare. Most of the Jewish children of World War II who were in occupied territory are dead. I am a rare, rare creature. And how is it that I'm here? Because there was a rare, rare human being who took responsibility and he saved me. I am the daughter of a woman who was friends with a person named Stanislav Grochulski. This is the man that is today being memorialized at Yad Vashem. That's the museum in Jerusalem that keeps records and case histories of people who have acted to save life as opposed to those who acted to destroy life. And because of that friendship, I lived. When we were informed that we must be at the railroad station on such a date at such a time, the question became, why? This is now occupied Poland. The year is 1942, and this is what we read on the wall of the Catholic Church, where they posted all their directions and instructions to all the occupied people, not just the minority Jews. We were a 10% minority in Poland, but the majority of 90% were Catholic people. All of us got our instructions from that wall. But every so often, the instructions were not directed to the citizens of Ujejovice, that's my town. The instructions were directed to the Jews of Ujejovice. The first time it happened, my mother and father became exceedingly upset because they said, what happened to our citizenship suddenly? Yesterday we were citizens, now we're just the Jews of Ujejovice. They realized that this segregation, this separation, this splitting the community was not good for us. But then we were an occupied country and nothing that was happening was good for any of us. But this time they chose not to obey the order. Now the first order that I remember that had come out earlier, and in that order, we were told that all Jews, again, the Jews of Ujejovice, must turn in all their valuables to headquarters. At which point, my mother sewed all her jewelry into her skirts, and my father sewed all his dollars, which he received from his American, from, well, they were Polish, immigrants to America, but they work and they earn some money. Not much. Immigrants who can't speak the language suffer. But whatever they earn, they send home. My father had dollars, sewed them into the shoulder pads of his jacket. My mother had a fur coat, and she said, no way was a Nazi going to keep warm under her fur coat. No way. And she wrapped it up and walked it to her good friend, Catholic lady, and she said to her, one day, mark my words, we're going to be free. And when we are, I'll come back for my coat. And the lady agreed, and the deal was done. And my parents protected the little that they had. It wasn't much, but it was all the wealth they had. They protected it. And now we are moving forward to to the dreadful date of the resettlement. Before that, there was another thing that they did that I want to point out because it tells you how when you are dealing with people who mean to reduce you to nothing, they find ways. If one thing doesn't work, they do another. And if that doesn't work, they do the next one. They didn't get our wealth, so they had us wear Stars of David. You may wonder, why all those Stars of David? What did that do? Well, it did a lot. You see, we were a Caucasian continent in Europe. The young Germans couldn't tell the Jew apart from the non-Jew because we all spoke the language of the country we lived in, although we spoke Yiddish, which turned out to be an advantage. Yiddish is the medieval German that, when the wandering immigrant Jews from defeat in from the ancient Romans, when they wandered into European countries, not the Spanish. The Spanish have another language which they created. But the idea was to find a way to talk to the people they lived among. And so they took medieval German and they created Yiddish. And that language was spoken at home. When we spoke to everyone else, we spoke Polish. The young Germans couldn't tell the Polish from the Jews from the non-Jews. They didn't understand what was being said. They were lost, and they couldn't persecute us adequately, and therefore, in my community, we wore, the adults, not children, we wore a white armband, blue stripe, blue Star of David at the middle, and now they knew who the Jews were at a glance, and now they could impose greater punishment, take away more food, give heavier assignments, and so on and so forth. But the one that really made it impossible for us to exist, we existed so far, no one in my family was hurt. We managed, we found ways to do it. We lived more at night than by day, but we lived. August 1942, all Jews must come to the railroad station. That was not, we couldn't defeat that. How could we had no friend in the world. We had nowhere to go. Helping us was now a crime. How many people will expose themselves to punishment to help other people? It becomes an impossible situation. But my father had learned from a German officer that was stationed in our home from 39 until I believe 41, when he went to the Russian front. That German officer, Mr. Arnold, had become friendly with my father because they loved to play chess. And as they played, the Yiddish and the German worked to their advantage, and they talked. And Mr. Arnold became my father's mentor, tutor. I do this all the time now. I talk to young people all the time, and I try to explain to them that I want to be your Mr. Arnold. I want to teach you ways of staying out of trouble and of saving yourself. But I really don't know the prescription for that. For that, I'm looking to them. I'm looking to young people for ideas. How do we keep safe? What do we do not to wind up being consumed by hatred? And that I don't know. But if I awaken enough interest, they'll find a way. They have to. They're not suicidal. They want to live. They have to find a way for us to overcome all that hatred that surrounds us. So August 1942, when we have to leave home because of resettlement, And the Germans say that they're resettling us to a better place in the East, where we will have better homes, better schools, better healthcare. Everything would be wonderful. And Mr. Arnold had taught my father, be careful of the big lie. The little lies you'll deal with, but the big lie kills. Be careful of that. And my father said, this is it. This is the big lie that will kill us. Now, mind you, we had never heard of death trains. It didn't exist in history. We had never heard of concentration camps or ghettos. Now we know that ghettos frequent. When you can't get out of a neighborhood, it becomes ghettoized. Everybody is poor and needy and so on. But that word came to us from a long history of segregation and trouble. So the question is, what do we do? Mr. Arnold had gone to the Eastern Front. We had no advisor. We had no one to tell us what to do. And we had nowhere to go and no one to help us. What do we do? My father decided that we'll go into the fields. The harvest had just been completed. And so we headed for the fields. Furthermore, my father informed every Jewish family in our community by word of mouth, because we had no fancy phones and all kinds of fancy stuff. We could only communicate by mouth. He informed them what we're doing and said, do whatever you can, but don't go to the trains. That's a killing lie. Don't go there. In our community, the only Jew who showed up at those death trains to go to what was promised to be a better place was my grandfather. He went to the trains because his argument was, you don't understand, he said to my father, the German people are people the world looks up to. They're a huge success in everything they touch because they're hardworking, they're industrious, they're talented. Oh, so much praise. He trusted the German people blindly. I trust no one blindly. No one. And I think it was an important lesson to have learned. And that's why I'm upset about Iran today. They're going to use those weapons for peaceful purposes like Hitler? We're done. And this time, the anxiety over our future existence is not just a Jewish problem. This time we're all done. And we better hold hands and find ways to survive. Because if we give in to this lie, it won't be good. At any rate, we left our home the night before resettlement and we went to the fields. And when we got there, we discovered that everything had been cut down and built into huge heaps on the fields. Call it haystacks if you like, but it was all kinds of grain. And we approached the haystack. We dug a hole on the bottom, and we little helpless mice crept inside, and we were going to hide there from the terrible invaders, the Nazis, from the big fat rats. Next to us was another such heap, and my aunt and uncle and their three children. My parents had four, they had three. We decided we're probably not going to make it, but at least we know each other while we're trying, and we'll see what happens. Now, while the weather was warm, this was livable. But you know what? The weather changes. And we could see it changing. And America had already entered the war in 1941. And Europe thought we would all be freed in no time at all because of America. But wars don't end quickly, and this one wasn't ending. And the winter was clearly approaching, so what's gonna happen here? I know that the adults can sit it, giving up. We might as well turn ourselves in and die, and that'll be it. But you don't do this if you don't have to. And so you wait another day and another day. And in the meantime, one night we heard a whistle. And my parents and my aunt and uncle said, that whistle is intended for us to hear. Who could it be? Is it an anti-Semite? Because you know Europe was terribly anti-Semitic and still is. They hide it, but it still is. Was it an anti-Semite, or maybe it was a friend looking to give us aid? Well, they speculated for a minute or two, and then they said, we have no choices here. We might as well answer. Whatever it is, we'll go with it. And they whistled back, because the friends knew that whistle, and that's how they used to reach each other to play games when they were little. You know, no cell phones around, so you whistle. And now, when Mr. Stanislav Grochulski heard the whistle, he ran in that direction and embraced his old friends. And he said, you're in terrible trouble. They're going to find you. They're looking for you all the time. They're riding around on their motorcycles. They're called Einsatzgruppen in German. And they're looking for Jews. They'll find you. And they'll do what they do to all the others. They shoot right on the spot. So he said, we have to find another way. We have a helper. We have to. And he became our eyes and ears. Every night he told us where to be the next night, because we never stayed more than one night for fear that we'd be discovered. Somebody might see and say, and we're done. So every night we had to meet him in a different place that he told us. And we did it. And every night he said to us, don't go there. That's where they're going to search tomorrow. Go where they already searched. And he kept us alive. But the weather was not stopping for our sakes. And one night my mother said to him, Stashek, you must do something more. You must build us a shelter. And he said, build a shelter with what? They took away every stick of wood, every nail, every hammer. How am I going to build? Furthermore, he said, my wife is so upset about our connection because she's afraid that one of these nights I'm not coming home. I'll be found and shot, and that'll be the end. And she cries every night when I leave. He said, how can I do more than I'm doing? Don't forget, I have a wife and children to take care of. And my mother said, wife? Stashek, I need to tell you something. My sister-in-law and I have jewelry. My husband has dollars. It's go home and tell your wife it's all hers if she agrees. And Mrs. Grochulski agreed. There's her spin on it, and I am very anxious to share it with you during Q&A if we have time, because I learned a great deal. At any rate, we made the deal. Oh, she wanted the fur coat. My parents went back at night, spoke to the lady who had the fur coat, who was in a panic, absolutely. She said, I'm not allowed to talk to you. That's against the law now. Go away. And my mother said, but you don't understand. If I go away, we'll die. And at the end, you will have to confess to your maker that you were a party to our deaths instead of saving our lives. Is that what you want? And the lady was a religious woman, and she said, no, she did not want that. So she said she must consult her priest. And my parents came back a few nights later, and the coat was ready with milk and bread and good wishes from the priest for a safe journey. We had another friend who came in handy later on. At any rate, the coat and the money and the jewelry, everything is given to Mrs. Grachowski. One night, moonless night, very dark, Mr. Grachowski comes and takes us to his home. The home is probably about this size. There's a ladder standing in the middle. We go up to the attics where we have hay, straw all around, and in the middle there are buckets. The buckets are for us to use as toilet, and the rest is our living space. And every night, Mr. Grachowski moves the ladder back into position, comes up, cleans the buckets, and then brings up a pot of boiled beans and potatoes for us to have. It's supposed to be our food for the next day, but we're starved, so we feed it right away and wait the next night again. And we are surviving. When it gets cold, really cold in the winter, Mr. Grachowski tells my mother that she has four brothers still surviving in the forest. And she says, the forest, they'll never survive. European winters are very cold. She says, you must bring them here. And he says, I can't, there's a curfew. How can I bring them here if I'm supposed to be here from sunset to sunrise the next morning? When am I gonna do this, bringing them here, because you can't reveal it, it has to be secretive. And my mother said, Stashek, you can do it, because God will protect you. She was a believer, and she believed that God would keep his eye on Mr. Grachowski. And Mr. Grachowski did the deed. He brought my four uncles, and he now has 15 Jews. The world doesn't give a damn about the Jews. We're a superfluous people. We have been cursed to death, and they feel that we are getting what we deserve. And Mr. Grachowski struggles. And my littlest sister, who I believe then was 2 years old, shows definite signs of death. And my mother decides that she's going to do a radical thing. She's going to save my little sister. How? They put her in a basket, they cover her up, they carry her back to the church of the priest that we have a connection with, and he does get a young childless couple to take care of her, but it's too late. My sister died because she was too sick by now. But the other 14 now, we lost one, there are still 14, we are struggling on. Soon my little cousin, who was older than my baby sister, he dies. My baby sister is resting on the Catholic cemetery of Ujayevica, my town. My little cousin is resting next to the house where we were hidden. Alongside him is his mother, a strong, healthy, able woman. Couldn't take it, and she died too. The rest of us are struggling on, and our general, Mr. Grachowski, is doing his best to keep us alive, and he succeeds. 12 of us survived in his attic for 2 years of the life I described. An extraordinary person. And I say, if there's one, there could have been more, but there was no will to save us. We were a people who were not wanted. And the danger of that kind of thing is greater now than it ever was. And the means of eliminating people will eliminate us all. No one will be safe unless we overcome the human weakness of killing each other. And this is what I now do. I retired from teaching in 1991, where I had written a curriculum for New York City on the teaching of the Holocaust. And that curriculum, I did not know, would wind up being my greatest help, because I really was not prepared to teach. And when I told my chairman, who said, I will underwrite a course if you teach it, I don't want anyone else, you have to teach it, I had to say no, because I avoided the subject. I didn't talk about it. I didn't know how. And he said to me, whenever you're ready, no rush, whenever you're ready. And I said, you don't understand. I don't know enough history to teach it. I can't do it. He said, well, you're young, you can learn. You see, he challenged me in a very nice and subtle and unpushy way. And I went back to school. And I learned what I had to learn. And I learned that I have a great responsibility to my family. I have two children, and I have four grandchildren, and I want them to enjoy life. But without help from others, they can't, because the world does not permit it. So now this is what I do. I volunteer my time, and I go wherever I'm invited to speak on this subject and to help you understand, so you can understand, explain to your kids that we must help. We must help each other overcome the difficulties that are facing us so clearly. So I hope that with this short kind of becoming familiar, you have some questions that'll help you understand what you don't understand. So please ask your questions.
Well, what was her perspective?
Thank you. Yes, that's the most important question. Mrs. Rucholsky, I could not face what really happened for a long time. My parents kept it a secret because we were sworn to secrecy. Mr. Rucholsky, when he finally, we were liberated by the Russians, then we finally said goodbye, and he told us how to find the Russian liberators at night crawling, because we couldn't walk and we couldn't talk. We had become skin and bones, lots of hair, and it was all lice infested. But the Russian army was familiar with this kind of thing. And the doctor they brought to us looked at us and he said, don't talk, I know. And he gave us a prescription. Eat very, very little. And do that for as long as it takes for your stomachs to learn to digest. Don't rush it, because if you do, you'll die. And we obeyed, and we recovered. But the physical recovery is not a full recovery. And we were suffering from loneliness, from missing people who never returned. We were the only 12 who returned to our region, nobody else. The pain of that was killing us. But we were adjusting, and we kept trying, and we're still trying, except though most are now gone. The only ones alive now are my two sisters and I, and two girl cousins who are my sister's ages. I was the oldest in the group of children, and I still am. So, I was answering that question. So that question has to do with the fact that once my parents were gone, the secret was beginning to seep out, and we shared with each other. And one day I said to my husband, I want to go to Poland. And he said, all right, we'll go. And when our two college kids came home and we told them, they said, I want to go, I want to go. We said, okay. Then they told their cousins. Everybody called. Can we come? Can we come? My husband made a deal with them. If you pay your fare, they raise the money, they pay their fare. We rented a minibus and we rode around Poland. And we wound up, we had a translator and a driver. We wound up on the steps of Mrs. Grochowski, who expected us because I had a letter written that I know it's a secret. May we come to visit you? I want you to meet my family. And she said, the secret is no secret anymore. Everybody knows, but she said, I don't discuss it with people that don't respect the information. So, sounded reasonable to me. We showed up. The welcome was wonderful. We partied. We had a good time. And one day, one night, while everybody was partying, I said to her, can we go and have a little talk? I still speak lousy Polish, but I'm understood. She said, yes. We were walking around her yard. And I said to her, Mrs. Grochowski, I have a very painful question to ask, but please don't refuse to answer. I need to know, why did you get involved with us Jews when you didn't have to? What possessed you? And she didn't want to talk about it either. People who survive a trauma don't want to go there. You people probably know it better than I. She didn't want to talk about it. And finally I begged. I said, don't you see everything I stand for depends on you being honest with me. Please, I beg you, tell me the truth. And she said, well, it's a very long story. When my husband was very young, his parents died because of an epidemic. And when his parents died, the aunts and uncles came from all over and they took one took one child, one took another. He had a lot of brothers and sisters. They took the children and they left Staszek, that's my mentor, my friend, my whatever, and my big hero, and his older sister. And they said to them, you're old enough to take care of yourselves. You don't need us. You will stay in your house and you will be fine. And Staszek and his sister Katya stayed in the house next to my grandparents. And my grandparents saw that they weren't fine, that they showed signs of needing attention. And so my grandparents saw to it that they weren't hungry, that they weren't cold, that they were properly clothed, that they went to school, and that they went to church. They did what good parents do for their children. They did for these children. And Mr. Grochowski said to his wife, don't you see, when I needed them, they took care of me. How can I abandon their family? And she loved her husband. And she said, I couldn't throw him out after that. She helped him. And I realized that caring is the answer. My grandparents cared for him. He cared for us. She cared for him. She helped care for us. Caring is the answer. If we care, we can save the day. He saved 12 people when the rest of the world didn't. Nothing for the Jew, nothing. So I ask you, can we teach them to care? Can we teach each other to care? I have faith, yes, I'm an optimist. After all is said and done, I remain an optimist. We can, because there's too much at stake now, too much. We either all live or we all die. Any other questions?
Where's your mentor?
Louder, please.
Where's your mentor?
Where is
Mr. Arnold?
Mr. Arnold, I am certain, died on the Russian front which was a terrible place of war, terrible place. Yeah, I'm sure of it.
How'd you make your way to the United States?
We made our way to the United States fairly quickly, although it took us time. When we left our home in Poland, because we didn't leave because we gave up. Apparently, I come from a family that does not give up. We stayed and stayed and struggled, and it wasn't easy. But one night there was a knock on the door, and the young men who knocked on the door came in. They were not from our village, they were from another village, but they said to my father, "You're Jews. We don't want any Jews in Poland. Go where you came from. Go to Palestine, you dirty Christ-killing Jews. If you stay here, we'll come back and kill you. Leave." And my father got up in the morning and he said, "We're gonna leave. We're gonna leave today. We had nothing to take. We didn't have any worries about how we're gonna get our furniture anywhere. We had none." So we left. But it's the old story. Where are we gonna go? How are we gonna get there? What are we gonna pay with? We have nothing. Well, the fields were good to us once. We went back into the fields and we walked. And my father said, "We're going to walk west." So we getting to Czechoslovakia was quick because it's very near. It was then one country. And once we got there, we had come across bombed out buildings. Europe was very, very damaged after the war. And we would go into these bombed out buildings and we would protect ourselves from the rain, but we would have the rats as neighbors, didn't frighten us. We dealt with them much more easily than with the Nazis. And we moved on from Czechoslovakia. We made our way to Romania, walking. Sometimes we took something that moved, but we had no coffee. So they threw us off at the next stop. So we walked some more. We cheated some more. And next country was Hungary. Next country was Austria. Now, so far, Poland, Czech, Romania, Hungary were Russian occupied. The Russians were unable to help refugees. Europe was full of refugees, because not only the Jews had suffered in the war, but everybody else did too. So the place was full of refugees, and the Russian army was poor as could be, and beaten. When we got to Austria, we encountered the British, but the British did not like the Jews, because the Jews stood in the way of an agreement with the Arabs. And so the British were not helpful to the Jews. So we kept walking. And the next place we hit, we got into American arms. And that made all the difference in the world. The Americans could help and had the will to help. And they came around and they asked how they could help and what they could do. And they said to my father, "Where would you like to make a home? You don't want to be a refugee forever. Where would you like to make a home?" My father said, "I don't care. Poland? Never!" But my father said, "I have two brothers in the United States. And if I thought I will see them again before I die, I'd die." So they said, "That's easy. We'll get it done. Don't worry." And they started, and my uncle used to tell us that one night there was a ring on his bell. He opened the door, and everybody in the American Armed Forces was represented on his stoop. And he said, "What happened? What did I do? Why are you here?" And they said, "You know, you have family alive in Europe." And My uncle said, no, you're mistaken. My brother had little children. You know they died first. They couldn't earn their keep for the Germans. So they killed them for... And the soldiers said, they're alive. Look, are these the people that you are, your family? And my uncle looked and he said, that's my family. And he said, do you want them? My uncle said, yeah. Here, fill out these papers and get going. And, but it took 2.5 years because coming to America is not easy. And only the luckiest come. And you know, the immigrants who come, we appreciate America for what it is. We recognize the goodness because we've seen the bad. So we know. The rest sort of take it for granted. Yeah, everybody's supposed to help everybody, and if they don't, oh well, what are you doing? But America is a very special place, and I am ever so grateful that it took this broken little 13-year-old illiterate child that I was and made a woman out of me.